look this morning at just a little backdrop that I think may be helpful in understanding the New Testament, because obviously there are a lot of things that the Apostle Paul wrote, as Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, that Paul said some things that are hard to understand and very, very confused approaches that a lot of people take for Paul's writing. So we're going to look a little bit this morning at some things that Paul said and try to pick up a little context in which he said them. Acts chapter 15, 1-7 basically crystallized the great struggle, the great problem that Paul experienced throughout his travels all through the New Testament. Acts chapter 15, 1-7. Notice what the problem was. It says, certain men which came down from Judea, now that's significant, they were Jews, and they were Christians. They were Jewish Christians. Taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. So folk, right here, we've got a, as Paul describes it in Galatians chapter 1, another gospel. And Paul says it's not another gospel, it's a perversion of the true gospel of Jesus Christ. And so there were Jewish Christians, those Jews that became followers of Christ, that still wanted to emphasize circumcision and the Jewish ceremonial law. And within that ceremonial law, that would include the sanctuary sacrifices and also the Jewish feast days. And so they wanted to maintain Jewish customs, Jewish religious practices. And they said to the Gentile brethren, they said, you've got to be circumcised, you've got to offer sacrifices in the sanctuary, and you've got to keep the feast days. And folk, the Apostle Paul had struggles with these Jewish converts throughout his entire ministry. And those were the struggles that Paul wrote about continually in his writings. And Acts 15 gives us the backdrop for that. Acts 15, 1-7. It says, when therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them. Isn't that interesting how Luke described that? They were probably going at each other's throats. I mean, Paul was a fiery fellow. He was a fiery fellow, Paul was. And it says there was no small dissension and disputation. Well, what do you do when you dispute with somebody? You're arguing with them. What's that, Nellie? There's anger. There's, you know, strong words that were flying back and forth. And Paul was not the kind of guy to back away from an argument or a fight. He didn't do that. And obviously the Holy Spirit had been leading him in a mighty way. A dramatic conversion there in Acts chapter 9. So Paul was not in the habit of backing away from an argument. So I just find it fascinating how Luke wrote that. It says, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. So Paul and Barnabas go up. It says they pass through Phinehas and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles. They caused great joy to all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders. And they declared all things that God had done with them. Now here we go. Here are those Jewish Christians again. Notice what they say. There rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, so they're Jews, which believed. They believed in Christ. So these are Jewish Christians who said it was needful to circumcise them, to command them to keep the law of Moses. So again, the Jewish Christians, they wanted the Gentile converts to keep the sacrificial services, circumcision, and the feast days. And the apostles and elders came together to consider this matter. And when there had been much disputing, now here's that word again. Folk, this was a time in the Christian church of the first century that if they didn't get it right here, it could have split the thing wide open. It was that volatile of an issue. And notice, it was so critical to the Jewish converts. They said, if the Gentiles don't do this, they can't be saved. So it was an issue of salvation to the Jewish Christians. An issue of salvation. And it never went away. Galatians 1, notice Paul's words, verses 6 through 8. Now, folk, this is just a little picture. I hope it's clear. Let me see if I can get that clearer. That's about as good as I'm going to get it. Here, of course, is the Mediterranean world. Rome is over here, the boot. Here's Greece over here, Macedonia, where Paul was told to come over and help us. Corinth is right down here. This was Asia Minor. The island of Patmos is right here. The seven churches of Revelation are right here. The Galatian churches were up here. And this is where Paul's writing this letter. And so Paul says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. So, folk, Paul was telling the Gentile world, salvation comes through faith in Jesus Christ. And the Jewish converts, after Paul would go in one place, he would preach salvation through faith in Christ, through submitting our lives to him. And Paul would then leave or be almost done with his meetings. And here come the Jewish Christians. And the Jewish Christians would say, oh no, they've got to be circumcised. They've got to keep the feast days. They've got to offer sacrifices in Jerusalem. So Paul was constantly in conflict with these Jewish Christians. And Paul said they were causing trouble and they were perverting the gospel of Christ. Now, in the book Acts of the Apostles, I think it's around page 388. I forgot to put down the exact reference here. But notice how Ellen White describes it. She parrots exactly what the Bible says. Through the influence of false teachers who had arisen among the believers in Jerusalem, there's those Christian Jews, they were false teachers. Division, heresy, and sensualism were rapidly gaining ground among the believers in Galatia. These false teachers were mingling Jewish traditions, see, it's very clear, with the truths of the gospel, ignoring the decision of the General Council at Jerusalem, which was in Acts 15. They urged upon the Gentile converts the observance of the ceremonial law. The situation was critical. The evils that had been introduced threatened speedily to destroy the Galatian churches. Now, folk, why was this a case where Paul couldn't back away? Well, if Paul backed away, then he'd have to completely change the gospel message of Scripture. And he wouldn't do that. And nobody should when it becomes at that level. So that's what was going on. Now, Notice as Paul writes here in Galatians, he very clearly specifies the problem that existed in the churches of Galatia. Notice Galatians 2:2-4. Paul says, I went up by revelation, communicated to them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. But neither Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, he was a Gentile, was compelled to be circumcised. And that because of false brethren unawares brought in, who came in privily to spy out our liberty which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. Well, folk, it's very clear here in Galatians 2:2-4, one of the issues that the churches in Galatia were struggling with. It was this right here. It was circumcision. And the Jewish Christians were saying, all the Greek Christians have got to be circumcised. And Paul said, no, they don't. Circumcision was a sign, as Paul says in Romans 4, verses 9 through 11, Paul says that circumcision was a sign of righteousness by faith. And in Deuteronomy, Moses understood. He understood the covenant sign of circumcision that was given to Abraham in Genesis 17. And Moses wrote, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thy heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. So circumcision was a sign of the cutting away of sin from the life through faith in Jesus Christ. Now that's what circumcision was all about. And that's what Paul understood. And that's clearly what the Old Testament taught. But the Jewish Christians said, no, if the Gentiles are going to be saved, they've got to be circumcised. Now here was the other issue in Galatians. Galatians 4, 9 and 10. Notice what it says. Now after ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? Ye observe days and months and times and years. Now, oftentimes, folk in other churches will say, this is talking about Seventh-day Adventists. You observe days. And then they stop. Is that what Paul was talking about here? See, folk, Paul has mentioned four things here. Days, months, times, and years. Was there anything in the Seventh-day Sabbath that had months connected to it? No. The Sabbath was set apart on the 7-day weekly cycle. There was nothing that had to do with months in the 7th-day Sabbath. So Paul clearly is not talking about the 7th-day Sabbath. But what is he talking about? Days, months, times, and years. What did the Jews have in their religious observances that had all four of these things? Days, months, times, and years. I've had people say to me, well, the times there, that had to do with soothsayers and palm readers. No, it didn't. It didn't. The times here mentioned have to do with set feasts. Distinct occasions, festivals that were set apart. That's what the Strong's Concordance states this word means. So where in the Jewish ceremonies do you have days, months, times, and years? Well, it's only found, folk, in one place. And that was the Jewish feast days. There were ceremonial Sabbath days that could fall on any day of the week. There were new moons, there were set festivals or times, And there were ceremonial years, whether it be the sabbatical year or the year of Jubilee. Now, all of those things, friend, connected to the Jewish feast days. It's the only thing in the Old Testament that had all four of those elements were the Jewish feasts. Now, here again, another picture of the Mediterranean world. You get your bearings. I always look for the boot. There's Rome, Greece, Asia Minor over here, the seven churches of Revelation. Galatia was up here. Now, the other place where Paul wrote about this in the New Testament was right here, Colossae, the Bible book we call Colossians. Was written to the church right here in Colossae. Colossae, as you can see maybe on your map, it was a neighboring town of Laodicea, which was just north and west of Colossae. Well, Paul dealt with this subject again in Colossians 2:11-17. Now, this passage, friend, is probably one of the most misunderstood passages of Christians today, Colossians 2:11-17. Let's analyze it together. Paul said, "In whom also you are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ." Do you see how Paul takes the covenant sign given to Abraham in Genesis 17, and he shows that it was symbolic of what the Lord wanted to do for the people in their lives. In their struggle with sin, circumcision was a sign of cutting away of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Do you see how Paul did that? Isn't that beautiful? So beautiful how he worded that and understood what circumcision was truly all about. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who has raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, there he did it again, uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. I guess, folk, in the final analysis, if we don't remember anything else in this message this morning, I hope we remember this, having forgiven you all trespasses. Because sometimes we spend all of our life, the first part of our life, we spend it doing things that we end up regretting. And the second half of our lives, we end up beating ourselves up for the things we did in the first half of our life. But we don't have to do that. Because through Christ, the Bible says, having forgiven you all trespasses. So if I will confess things that I have done that are wrong and say, Lord, forgive me, and circumcise from my mind sin and temptation. Well, folk, I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven. And you're forgiven. And I don't have to live with that burden anymore. Don't have to. Now, let's get to the tough part of what Paul said. I think this is pretty clear where Paul has taken circumcision and shown its spiritual meaning. Now we go to the tough part. Verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Now, was something obliterated when Jesus died, based on what Paul just said? Something was. Something was in existence throughout the Old Testament up until Jesus died, there was something that was in existence, but when he died, it was gone. Because the Bible says it was blotted out. Now, I know when I make a mess on a counter and I get a washcloth and I wipe it up, it's gone. I blotted it out. It disappeared. And Paul emphatically says that there was an ordinance that was blotted out. It was nailed to the cross of Christ. Now the question is, what ordinances were against us and were nailed to the cross of Christ? Now, the word ordinance, according to the Strong's Concordance, Webster's Dictionary, an ordinance is a law. That's what it is. Some law, friend, some law was nailed to the cross. Some law was blotted out by the crucifixion of Christ. It's very clear. Now, oftentimes on legal record books, counties, states, national governments, they have like ordinance 1.452314. Well, an ordinance is a law. Plain and simple. So there was a law that was nailed to the cross. Now, there's also another meaning for an ordinance. About once a quarter, we participate in something called the ordinance of what? What's it called? Communion. That's right, communion, the ordinance of humility. We wash one another's feet. We partake of the bread and the juice. That's an ordinance. We call it that. And an ordinance, while it is a law, it also, in a secondary sense, it's something where people participate. They do something where there's an ordinance. And Paul said it was blotted out and nailed to his cross. And Paul says, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Christ won. He was victorious. He conquered. Praise the Lord, he did. He won a victory. He won the victory, whereby we can win victory too. Now, Paul says this, because Jesus died on the cross, and because he blotted out a law at the cross, Paul says this, therefore, let no man judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of the new moon or of the Sabbath. The word days has been supplied by the King James translator. Shouldn't be there. It should simply say meat, drink, holy day, new moon, or of the Sabbath. Which are a shadow of things to come, but the body of Christ is also supplied. It should not be there. Now, the Christian, pseudo-Christian world says, because Jesus nailed the law to the cross, don't tell me about your Sabbath. Don't they? It's exactly what they say. Don't tell me about the seventh-day Sabbath, because Paul said, don't judge people about the Sabbath. And besides about the Sabbath, You vegetarians out there, don't tell me I can't have an occasional burger from McDonald's. Or if I want to go to the local restaurant and have a T-bone steak, don't tell me I can't. And if I want to sip a little wine at dinner, Paul says don't judge people about what they drink because it was nailed to the cross. So now I can eat what I want, I can drink what I want, and I can go to church on any day that I want. Have you ever heard that before? Liz? That's exactly right, Liz. That's 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31. Whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Now, Liz, that's a very good point. We take that passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, and we interpret this passage the way I just did. Now we have Paul talking out of both sides of his mouth. And we have a stark confusion over these simple Bible passages. So, the verse in 1 Corinthians 10:31 is too obvious. It's so clear. What then is Paul talking about here? If he's not talking about meat and drink, and what I eat and what I drink, and if he's not talking about the seventh-day Sabbath, what is he talking about? See, it's our job and our privilege to harmonize Scripture. Because the Holy Spirit is not confusion. There is total harmony in the Bible. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, if Paul's not talking about a vegan diet or a vegetarian diet there, or the fact that I want to eat flesh food, what is he talking about? Well, how many different things here did Paul mention? Let's see if we can count them. Meat, there's one. Drink is two. Holy day is three. New moon is four. And Sabbath is five. Now, folk, let me ask you, were there any prohibitions on the Sabbath? If we're going to say this is the seventh day of the week, well, was it based on the new moon? It wasn't, was it? It was based on the seven-day weekly cycle. Was there any prohibition? Because these all go together. Anything about meat that had to do with the seventh-day Sabbath? No, there wasn't. Drinking? No, nothing in connection to the Sabbath throughout the Old Testament. But what was there in the Jewish economy that contained all five of these things? Meat, drink, holy day, new moon, and Sabbath. Somebody tell me. There was something in the Old Testament that the Jews were involved in their religious convocations, that had all five of these characteristics. The feast days did. Now, the commandments contained in ordinances were abolished. Okay, ordinances are laws. There are also things where people participate. Okay, we already said that. We call foot washing the ordinance of humility. In an ordinance, people have a part. They were nailed to the cross because they all pointed forward to what Christ would do for man and in man. And Paul, in this context, mentions the ordinances that were abolished, circumcision and the feast days. Now, let's go in our Bibles Numbers chapter 28. And let's notice something here. Within the Jewish feast days, let's notice what was involved in every single Jewish feast day. Okay, it's in Numbers chapter 28, and we're going to be looking in verses 16 to 24. Okay? Now, when we do this, I want you to keep in mind the five things that Paul mentioned in Colossians 2. And we're going to see if we can find those five elements. Okay? Meat, drink, holy day, new moon, Sabbath. Okay, those five things. Okay, let's watch. In the 14th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord. Now, the Passover, of course, was the first feast of the Jews, Passover or unleavened bread. So clearly it's talking about the Jewish feast days. And it's talking here about the first one, which was Passover unleavened bread. Now, it says the 14th day of the first month. What's month have to do with, friends? How did they decide when the month would begin? How did they do that? What's another word for month? Somebody tell me? Moon. The setting aside of the monthly cycle was always based on the moon. Had nothing to do with the weekly cycle, but it had everything to do with the monthly cycle. And that was based on the moon, the new moon. Now, did Paul mention anything about the new moon in Colossians chapter 2? Did he? Yeah, he did, didn't he? Let's go back there for just a second. Let's see our five things again. He said, don't judge anybody in meat or drink or holy days or of the new, what? The new moon. So that was one of them right there, folks. Here's our new moon right here. And on the 14th day after the new moon, or the beginning of the first month, was the Passover of the Lord. So the Jewish feast days were not based on the seven-day cycle, were they? They were based on the moon, the new moon. And Paul mentions it right here. He shows when the feast day was calculated, it was based on the moon. There's one of our parts that Paul brought out in Colossians 2, isn't it? There's the first one. Going on. The 15th day of this month, okay, so here again, he's emphasizing the fact that the feast days were built around the moon or the monthly cycle. 7 days shall unleavened bread be eaten. In the first day shall be a holy convocation. Now, do you remember the word Paul used in Colossians 2? To talk about a holy convocation? What was it? Holy day. That's exactly right, Liz. Remember? Don't judge in meat or drink or in respect of a holy day. So there's our holy convocation, isn't there? Now we have two parts. Two parts that Paul talked about. Both of them are found in the Jewish feasts. Now, Paul goes on, he says, it's a holy convocation. You shall do no manner of servile work therein. Now, what do you call it if you set aside a day and you don't work? What do you call that day? What's it called? Okay, we've already know it's a holy day, but if you don't work on that holy day, what do you specifically call it? a Sabbath. That's right, a Sabbath. Now, folk, we have three parts that Paul mentioned in Colossians 2. Based on the moon, the new moons, a holy day, and it's also a Sabbath. And folk, because it's a Sabbath that's built around the new moon, that feast day Sabbath could fall on any day of the week. It could fall on Tuesday, Monday, Sunday, Friday. It could fall on any day of the week. There's three parts, isn't there? Now, what were the other two parts that we'd need to look for? Meat, yeah, drink and meat. We've got the holy day, new moon, and Sabbath. Those are all taken care of. Meat and drink. Let's see if we find it in Numbers chapter 28 and 29. Going on, let's go down to verse 20 now in Numbers 28. Notice what Paul says, or Moses said. And their what offering? Meat. So with the Jewish feast days, there were meat offerings. You say, well, what part of the animal was offered? It wasn't flesh food that was offered. It's very interesting in Scripture. When the word meat is used, typically, almost always, it simply means food. If it's actual animal flesh, it's called flesh. And that's how the Bible translates it. In this case, the meat offerings had nothing to do with animal flesh. It was actually, folk, it was grain that was offered on these feast days. And what they would do is they would take, whether it was the wheat, the barley, they would crush it, make it into flour, and then make some bread, rolls, and they would use that to offer as part of their offerings. So the meat offering really had nothing whatsoever to do with flesh food. So Paul's comment here in Colossians 2, this has nothing to do with diet at all. Nothing to do with diet at all. Drink, that's the last one, is that drink? Well, we've seen four things that are connected to the Jewish feast day. Notice verse 24 of Numbers chapter 28. After this manner ye shall offer daily throughout the 7 days the meat of the sacrifice made by fire. Okay, well there it's, now we're talking about flesh, meat. Of a sweet savor to the Lord. It shall be offered besides the continual burnt offering and his what offering? Drink. Within the Jewish feast days were every single component that Paul mentioned in Colossians 2. New moons, holy days, Sabbath, meat offerings, and drink offerings. Folk, what Paul was saying in Colossians 2 was that when Jesus died, all of the Jewish feast days pointed forward to him. They ceased to be necessary to be honored any longer because the substance of all of those feasts had come. And now the people were to look at Christ and all of his goodness for them. And Paul says, at the cross, the Jewish feast days and circumcision were blotted out and were nailed to the cross of Christ. That's what Paul said. All the Jewish feasts were built around the new moon. The new moon determined when the feasts would be celebrated. Each feast had a holy convocation or a ceremonial Sabbath feast day. At each feast, there were meat and drink offerings. These are all the components that Paul described in Colossians 2, 16 and 17. Do you know what kind of drink was offered on the feast days? It was grape juice. Unfermented grape juice. There was only one feast that was not based on the new moon. It was based on the 7-day weekly cycle. And the way that Moses was told to write it in Leviticus 23, 2 to 4, it's very beautiful because, well, let's read it. Leviticus 23, Leviticus 23, Verse 2, speak to the children of Israel, say to them, concerning the feasts of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts. So God says, I'm going to tell you about my feasts right now. Verse 3, 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest, a holy convocation. You shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. So Moses sets apart the seventh day Sabbath based on the weekly cycle. Verse 4. And now he basically repeats what he said in verse 2. These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which ye shall proclaim in their seasons. It's very clear and it's very beautiful the way the Lord shows that the Sabbath was a feast, but it was different than all the other feasts. It was based on the weekly cycle and it was eternal. And then he repeats the fact that there are other feasts that are totally different from the weekly seventh-day Sabbath. And those feasts are based upon the new moon. So the Lord very clearly shows the distinction between the seventh day of the week and all of the other ceremonial Jewish feast days that were based on the new moon. Very beautiful. Nellie, please. Other 9 of them, yeah. Absolutely, Nellie. And it's those verses, Nellie, in Colossians 2 that people will use. Absolutely. What is so beautiful to me is, in studying this through, because, you know, coming into Adventism, well, my, Nellie, I'm not going to become a Seventh-day Adventist because somebody tells me to. I'm going to become a Seventh-day Adventist Christian because it's in the Bible. And if I can't base and prove what I do from Scripture, I'm not going to do it. Forget it. I'm not going to have anything to do with it. Well, Nellie, these were some of the verses that were thrown at me right in the very beginning of me becoming a Seventh-day Adventist. So I stepped back and I said, okay, obviously it says Sabbath there. Let's be fair. That's what it says, Sabbath. And it says that it was nailed to the cross. So I had to step back and say, okay, does that mean the seventh day of the week was nailed to the cross? Because that's how people told me that that's what it meant. And I looked at it and I said, well, meat? What does meat and drink have to do with the Sabbath? There's no connection whatsoever. Then when you come over here to the new moon, I said, wait a minute. The seventh day Sabbath was based on the weekly cycle of 7 days. But Paul says there's a new moon connected to this Sabbath. So I'm going, wait a minute. The seventh day Sabbath was a weekly cycle. Didn't have anything to do with the moon. And I said, but wait a minute. There was a Jewish festival. There were Jewish feasts that were based on the new moon. And they had ceremonial Sabbaths connected to them that were called holy days. And within those Jewish feast days, there was drink and meat offerings. So then you step back and you say, well, wait a minute. Paul's not talking there about the seventh day of the week at all. He's talking about Jewish feast days that pointed forward to Christ. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful. And again, that's our job, that's our privilege to harmonize Scripture. That's our job. Paul said that the feast days were a shadow of things to come, but the body is Christ. Now, when you see a shadow like that on the pavement, or right now, as I'm standing here in the light, I can see my shadow right over here. What does that mean? Well, if you see a shadow, you know that there is a body that is connected to it, and the body is close by. Paul's argument is the Jewish feast days and ceremonies were shadows. And who were they all pointing forward to but Jesus Christ? Now, we have a few other passages that are used by nominal Christianity today to say, well, this is talking about the Sabbath too. Romans 14, verse 5. One man esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. And a Christian, nominal Christian today will say, you want to exalt the Sabbath? Go ahead. I'm going to exalt Sunday. And it doesn't make a hill of beans of difference which one you choose, because Paul said, one man esteems one day above another, another esteems every day alike. Is that what Paul was saying? No, he wasn't. The issue of Sabbath and Sunday was not in the first century. The issue here had to do with one Jewish Christian exalting the Passover ceremonial Sabbath, and another one exalting the ceremonial Sabbath on the Day of Atonement. And Paul says, you guys want to exalt this day? You want to exalt the one at Passover? You want to do the one at the Day of Atonement? You just be fully persuaded in your own mind. But as far as Paul was concerned, didn't amount to a hill of beans. Nellie's comment for the camera is that a friend or acquaintance of hers says, you know, the Sabbath is the day that you decide you're going to take off as a day of rest, basically. It's amazing. But There were those in Rome who were pushing one feast day above another, making it critical for salvation. Paul struggled with these people throughout his ministry. It never stopped. He admonished, "Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind." The ceremonial system was made up of symbols pointing to Christ, to his sacrifice and his priesthood. This ritual law with its sacrifices and ordinances was to be performed by the Hebrews until type meant antitype and the death of Christ. All the sacrificial offerings were to cease. All the ceremonial feast days of the Jews were to cease. It was this law that Christ took out of the way, nailing it to his cross. That quote right there is from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 365 or 366, one of the two. Now, before we close, I want to look just briefly at each of the Jewish feast days to show how they pointed forward to something Christ would do. The first feast of the Jews was Passover unleavened bread. It's mentioned in Leviticus 23, 5 to 14. It's also in Numbers 28. Paul makes it very clear this feast pointed forward to Christ, our Passover, who is sacrificed for us. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 8. So the Passover pointed forward to Christ, our Passover. Pentecost, referred to in Leviticus 23, 15 to 22. It also is in Numbers 28. This feast took place 50 days after the wave sheaf offering of the first fruits of the grain, which was waved across the altar by the priest on the 16th day of the first month. 50 days after that, when all the grain crops were harvested and in the barrels in the barn, then it was time for Pentecost. 50 days after Christ rose, and as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, Christ was the first fruits. 50 days after Jesus rose, Christ was inaugurated as man's high priest in the most holy place, not the most holy, but in the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And it was on that day that you had the great outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the first fruits of Christ's sacrifice were harvested at Pentecost. The Feast of Trumpets occurred in the autumn of the year, seventh month, first day of the month. Feast of Trumpets was 10 days before the Day of Atonement. It's mentioned in Leviticus 23, 24, and 25. Due to the fact that this feast had end-time ramifications like all the other feasts, this feast corresponds with the blowing trumpet of William Miller and others calling the world to judgment in 1844. This Feast of Trumpets would correspond to the mid-1830s and the warning message to prepare to meet thy God. Christ called upon Miller and the others to proclaim the fact that something of great significance was going to happen in the early 1840s. That was the latter-day Feast of Trumpets. Day of Atonement, referred to in Leviticus 23, 26 to 32, points forward to the work of Christ in the most holy place of the sanctuary in heaven. This work began in 1844. So the Feast of Atonement points forward to Christ's ministry in the most holy place since 1844. Finally, the last feast was the Feast of Tabernacles. It's referred to in Leviticus 23, 34 to 41. The Feast of Tabernacles was after all of the orchard fruits, the apples, the mango, papaya, all of the fruits that would grow in the land of Canaan. When those were all harvested and brought into the bins for that year, then they had the Feast of Tabernacles. It was the final ingathering. All the ingathering of fruits was done, and they would have a feast. Folk, the Feast of Tabernacles points to the second coming of Christ, when the final harvest of human beings will be gathered into the heavenly home. So you can see how all the Jewish feasts were shadows pointing forward to Christ and what he would do on behalf of humanity. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you today for the beauty of Scripture. Thank you for the harmony of your word. Thank you that by looking at different portions of the Bible, we can see clearly your message of truth. We give you praise today for this amazing, amazing book. We just pray, Lord, that you would help us each and every day to rightly divide that word so that we see beautiful harmony in its pages. And we just pray that the beauty and the harmony of those pages would be worked out in our heart and in our mind. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.